So the United States is and remains the one indispensable nation. America must always lead on the world stage. No one else will. I believe in American exceptionalism with every fiber of my being.
Herzlich willkommen zu Klagemauer TV, liebe Zuschauer. US-Regierung verletzt Menschenrechte. Das ist heute unser Thema im Studio Wiesbaden. Unmittelbar nach den Anschlägen am 11. September 2001 beauftragte US-Vizepräsident Cheney ganze Kohorten von Rechtswissenschaftlern in völliger Geheimhaltung, um juristische Rechtfertigungen für die Ausweitung der Regierungsmacht auszuarbeiten. Als Resultat durften zum ersten Mal in der Geschichte der USA Häftlinge psychisch und physisch gefoltert werden. Terrorverdächtige wurden entführt und ohne Erhebung einer Anklage auf unbestimmte Zeit festgehalten, und das nicht nur in Guantanamo. Neben Guantanamo und Bagram halten die USA in weiteren Internierungslagern und sogenannten Black Sites, das sind geheime Gefängnisse, weitere Terrorverdächtige gefangen. Dort sind die Gefangenen ohne Kontakt zu ihren Familien, Rechtsanwälten oder internationalen Organisationen wie dem Roten Kreuz. Ungeschminkt zeigt sich hier einmal mehr das wahre Gesicht der US-Regierung. Vordergründig spielt sie sich als weltweiter Bekämpfer von Folter und Menschenrechtsverletzungen auf. Aber hinten herum erarbeitet sie für sich die juristische Legitimation von Folter und Menschenrechtsverletzungen. Wie gut, dass diese Maske nun überall zu bröckeln beginnt. Helfen auch Sie mit, dass die Maske der USA weiter bröckelt und das wahre Gesicht zum Vorschein kommt, indem Sie von diesen Nachrichten in Ihrem Umfeld erzählen. Wir freuen uns, wenn Sie auch bei unserer nächsten Sendung wieder mit dabei sind. Auf Wiedersehen.
With more than 2 million people currently incarcerated, the United States trumps China, Russia and the rest of the world in the number of prisoners doing time. About half of those in U.S. jails are in for nonviolent offenses. Since 1990, America's private prison population has increased 1,600%. The war on drugs, mandatory sentencing and a broken immigration policy have forced more people into prison.
My expertise, as you know, is CIA, Marine Corps, 3 CIA secret wars. I had a position in the National Security Council in 1975 as the chief of the Angola task force running the secret war in Angola. It was the third CIA secret war I was part of. The national security law creating the National Security Council and the CIA, as you know, was passed in 1947. The CIA was given this charter to perform such other duties and function as might be necessary to the national security interests, and given a vague authority to protect its sources and methods. I think it was in the mid-80s that I coined this phrase, the Third World War, because in my research I realized that we were not attacking the Soviet Union and the CIA's activities, we were attacking people in the Third World. And I'm going to just quickly, in the interest of time, just give you a little sense of what that means, this Third World War. Basically, it's the third, I believe, in terms of loss of life and human destruction, the third bloodiest war in all of history. They undertake to run operations in every corner of the globe. They also undertook the license of operating just totally above and beyond U.S. laws. They had a license, if you will, to kill, but also they took that to a license to smuggle drugs, a license to do all kinds of things to other people in other societies in violation of international law, our law, and every principle of nations working together for a healthier and more peaceful world. Meanwhile, again, they battled to convert the U.S. legal system in such a way that it would give them control of our society. Now, we have massive documentation of what they call the secret wars of the CIA. We don't have to guess or speculate. We had the Church Committee investigate them in 1975, gave us our first really in-depth, powerful look inside this structure. Senator Church said in the 14 years before he did his investigation that he found they had run 900 major operations and 3,000 minor operations. And if you extrapolate that over the whole period of the 40-odd years that we've had a CIA, you come up with 3,000 major operations and over 10,000 minor operations. Every one of them illegal, every one of them disruptive of the lives and societies of other peoples, and many of them bloody and gory beyond comprehension almost. Extensively, we manipulated and organized the overthrow of functioning constitutional democracies in other countries. We organized secret armies and directed them to fight in just about every continent in the world. We encouraged ethnic minorities to rise up and fight. People like the Mosquito Indians in Nicaragua, the Kurds in the Middle East, the Hmongs in Southeast Asia. And of course, we have organized and we still do and fund death squads in countries around the world, like the Treasury Police in El Salvador, which are responsible for most of the killing of the 50,000 people just in the 80s, and there were 70,000 before that. And orchestration, CIA secret teams, and propaganda led us directly into the Korean War. We were attacking China from the islands, Kaimoi, Matsu, Thailand, Tibet. A lot of drug trafficking involved in this, by the way, until eventually we convinced ourselves to fight the Chinese in Korea, and we had the Korean War, and 1 million people were killed. Same thing for the Vietnam War, and we have extensive documentation of how the CIA was involved at every level, or the national security complex, because it's a very cooperative thing, into manipulating the nation into the Vietnam War. And we wound up creating the Golden Triangle, in which the CIA, Air America airplanes were flying in arms to our allies and flying back out with the heroin. We launched the largest, this is something that Jimmy Carter did, Admiral Turner brags about it, the operation in Afghanistan. Biggest single operation, I'm told, in the history of the CIA's secret wars. And sure enough, very quickly we produced the Golden Crescent, which is still the largest source of heroin perhaps in the world today. Trying to summarize this Third World War that the CIA, the U.S. National Security Complex, with the military all interwoven in it in many different ways, has been waging. Let me just put it this way. The best heads that I coordinate with studying this thing, we count at least, minimum figure, 6 million people who've been killed in this long 40-year war that we've waged against the people of the Third World. These are not Soviets. We have not been parachuting teams into the Soviet Union to kill and hurt and maim people, especially not since 1954, when they developed actually a capability of dropping atomic weapons on the United States. They aren't British, French, Swedes, Swiss, Belgians. We don't do bloody, gory operations in the countries of Europe. These are all people of the Third World. They're people of countries like the Congo, Vietnam, Kampuchea, Indonesia, Nicaragua, where conspicuously they nor their governments do not have the capability of doing any physical hurt to the United States. They don't have ICBMs, they don't have armies or navies. They could not hurt us if they wanted to. There has rarely been any evidence that they really wanted to. And that, in fact, is perhaps the whole point. If they had had ICBMs, we probably wouldn't have done the things to them for fear of retaliation. Cheap shots, if you will, killing people of other countries of the world who cannot defend themselves under the guise of secrecy and under the rubric of national security.
So the United States is and remains the one indispensable nation. America must always lead on the world stage. No one else will. I believe in American exceptionalism with every fiber of my being.
Danke, Freunde. Niemand hinderte eigentlich die Amerikaner daran, die Ostukraine als eine terroristische Organisation anzuerkennen und Bombenschläge auszuführen. Denn zum Großteil gibt es heutzutage kein internationales Recht, wie sich herausgestellt hat. Die Amerikaner entscheiden selbst, was gut ist und was schlecht, welcher Staat Terroristensponsor ist und welche Organisation eine Terrorgruppe darstellt. Ich will nicht die Islamische Staat rechtfertigen. Aber wenn die Regierung Iraks die Amerikaner einlud, so hat Syrien keine Freigabe erteilt. In welcher Realität leben wir? Sind wir am Rande eines Krieges? Die Realität ist einfach. Die Amerikaner kämpfen um ihre Führungsrolle um jeden Preis. Sie halten sich für die oberste Rasse. Lasst uns ehrlich sein. Sie halten sich für die oberste Rasse, die alles darf auf dieser Welt. Das, was ihnen Interessen entspricht, ist richtig. Sie führen ein neues System der Pseudowerte ein. Gut ist das, was für Amerika günstig ist. Alles andere ist schlecht. Und daher kann man Menschen bomben und morden in beliebiger Zahl. Amerikaner haben das internationale Recht zerstört. Beginnend mit 90er Jahren haben sie planmäßig alle Strukturen internationaler Abmachungen gestürzt. Sie traten von Verträgen zurück, dann, wann es für sie günstig war, und sie setzen diese Politik heute fort. Sie versuchen, den eigenen Vorteil allen anderen aufzuzwingen, als einzig richtigen Gesetz, Normen und Regeln. Die oberste Rasse darf alles, alle anderen haben nur darauf zu hören, was Amerika sagt. Und das ist sehr beängstigend, denn in Wirklichkeit diese durch Amerikaner ausgedachte Messianismus, der sich selbst entlassene Ablassbrief für beliebige Verbrechen, es stellt die Welt an den Rand eines Krieges. Der Planet ist in Gefahr. Lasst uns ehrlich sein, die ganze Welt hat die Amerikaner satt und ihre Mission als die wichtigste Instanz. Aber die Amerikaner selbst bemerken das nicht und ziehen es vor, die eigenen Probleme zu lösen, indem sie Probleme für andere erschaffen. Sie bedrohen den Weltfrieden wirklich und real.